Hello, very good morning. Welcome along to Ireland AM. It's Thursday, the 10th of August.
It is.
It's great to have you with us.
It really is. Coming up this morning, we've got wannabe golfers, a what to watch list, and the weird and wonderful news from the past couple of weeks.
What a wonderful show. Yes. We're going to start off finding out why a man in Japan spent over $15,000 to become a dog when we break down all... That's not him.
That's him.
All the bizarre news stories you may have missed this week.
That is a human being. Just to let you know, we're going to be talking about that in just a little while. Plus, the wonderful Steve Martin is back on our screens with his telly show, Only Murders in the Building. Brian Lloyd is bringing his top TV and movie picks of the week.
We're also swinging into action with some golf challenges when broadcasters Pamela Joyce and Lorraine Keane stop by at 20 past nine.
You feeling competitive?
I will be.
You will be. You will be by 9 o'clock, yeah. Alan is over there. He's back in the studio from Mullingar. We're going to do a bit of set dancing during the break.
Did you like my set dancing yesterday?
I thought you were brilliant. Like, properly brilliant.
Oh, there we go.
I really enjoyed it.
There you go. Now, we've plenty of flower power on the show this morning. Gardener Catherine Carton will be giving us sage advice, on growing kitchen herbs, while Erin Bunting shows us how to use fragrant flowers to make a sweet treat in the kitchen. All that, plus we're learning how to boogie. I see dancing. Once they see me once, they can't get enough of it.
Can't get enough.
So we'll be doing some Bollywood dancing at 9:45. Time now for the news. Let's head over to the Virgin Media News Hub, and here's Anne O'Donnell.
Thanks, Alan. Good morning. Well, a powerful typhoon is bearing down on South Korea this morning. Many properties have been boarded up where residents are being evacuated. It comes after thousands of scouts, including an Irish group, have been moved to safety.
Storm Kanun is making its presence felt in South Korea as it begins to move up the Korean peninsula. It's forecast Kanun's winds will strengthen to typhoon levels with torrential rain as they slam into major urban areas. Kanun is expected to drop between 10 and 40 centimetres of rain in southern and eastern regions. Some properties are boarded up against the incoming storm, with many people evacuating their homes. Dozens of flights and ferry services have been grounded and tens of thousands of fishing vessels have returned to ports. Government officials are concerned about potentially huge damage from flooding, landslides and tidal waves triggered by typhoon-strength winds. The storm is expected to weaken as it moves to North Korea tomorrow. Kanun has already forced South Korea to evacuate the World Scout Jamboree in the southwestern county of Buan. More than 1,000 buses moved 37,000 scouts, including an Irish contingent, to safety ahead of the storm. Marie Mulcahy, Virgin Media News.
An Ecuadorian presidential candidate has been shot dead as he left a political rally in the capital. Fernando Villavicencio said he had been receiving multiple death threats before the attack, including from leaders of Mexico's Sinaloa cartel. At least 9 others were injured in the incident. At least 6 people have died as wildfires that tore through the heart of the Hawaiian island of Maui reduced much of an historic town to ash. Well, dozens of people were injured in the inferno. The exact cause of the blaze is not yet known, but officials say a number of factors, including high winds and low humidity, may have contributed to the blaze.
There's hundreds of homes leveled down to the ground. The historic section of the town is destroyed. All the historic buildings, Lahaina used to be the capital of all of Hawaii. Even the boats in the harbor were burned down to the water. They're gone. So the whole front street of Lahaina, all the shops, the businesses are all gone.
And thousands of travellers are being affected by the deadly wildfires in Maui. The main airport there was sheltering 2,000 travellers whose flights were cancelled or recently arrived on the island. Officials are now preparing the Hawaiian Convention Centre in Honolulu to take in thousands of displaced tourists and locals.
Luckily, I had someone that I could stay with. If it weren't for them, I don't know where I would have ended up. It's just scary to see a big wildfire just kind of coming your way. And it's not something I ever experienced before.
And the US President Joe Biden has signed an executive order banning some US investments in sensitive technology in China, specifically those in artificial intelligence, quantum computing and semiconductors. It comes after Mr. Biden said technological progress in the sectors posed significant national security risks as advances could help develop sophisticated weapons and help spy agencies break crypto codes. The new executive order will come into force next year.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
This morning we'll see a good deal of cloud at first with limited sunny spells and possible patchy drizzle and mist and fog most prevalent in southern areas with patchy light rain at times. Some better sunny spells will develop through the morning but becoming breezy as moderate to fresh southeasterly winds develop. This afternoon then showery rain will push into the west and southwest extending northeastwards through the rest of the day, turning heavy at times with highest temperatures of 18 to 23 degrees. Showery rain will clear northeastwards through the first half of the night as moderate to fresh southeasterly winds ease for a time, allowing mist and hill fog to form. Clear spells and showers will follow from the southwest and the winds will increase towards morning with overnight temperatures between 12 and 15 degrees.
Chill insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
It's time now to take a look at this morning's paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline, TDs call for mortgage relief as rates rise above 4%. Independent TDs are demanding action ahead of the budget to help struggling homeowners after interest rate rise and a 10.7% national rent increase.
NCT calls in Gardaí over broker site offering test dates. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. A British website claiming to be an intermediary has been offering slots for car tests in Ireland. It resembles the official website and charges a total of over €131 for the booking and test.
The Examiner leads with UHL staff fearing winter collapse. The staff of University Hospital Limerick has said that they are increasingly fearful about what the winter will bring as they struggle to cope with overcrowding in August already. Yesterday, the hospital had 100 people on trolleys waiting for beds.
Following that, Taoiseach, we face a new wave of COVID is the top story on the Daily Mail. The number of people in hospital with the virus has more than tripled in the last 2 weeks. A new, more transmissible variant has been detected here after a spike in cases around the world.
The Mirror goes with Panic Station. Official figures show that nearly 4 in 10 people were not paying for their TV licence fee.
And The Sun leads with Duffy's Late Wait Show. Former Today FM presenter Louise Duffy is being considered as the first female host of The Late Late Show after Patrick Kilty's run ends in 3 years' time.
Star leads with El Chapo, the morning to you. Dual Mexican-Irish citizen Maris O'Shea Salazar has been named in a South American court as a key player in El Chapo's Sinaloa cartel.
And the Herald goes with when Porsche comes to shove. A 21-year-old man allegedly dragged the owner of a Porsche 911 from his sports car in South Dublin before driving it erratically around the city, causing 60 grand's worth of damage.
Janie Mackers, God, I hope he's okay. We'll be talking about the top stories. That's coming up just after the break. See you in a minute. Now it's time to delve into the stories making the headlines this morning.
Joining us this morning is journalist Aoife Barry. Good morning,
morning
to you, Aoife.
Morning.
Let's start off with mortgage rates and rents.
Oh, God.
Yeah, kick off the morning.
A really happy story this morning. Everything is free, you know.
Imagine that. The budget isn't here yet.
Just like the Lewis.
I wish. It's all free.
So average rent has hit €1,800 as mortgage rates rise.
Yeah, exactly, €1,800. It's unbelievable if you look back at what people were paying back in, say, you know, about 2020, which obviously is a strange year because of the pandemic, but rates around them are about 1,300 or thereabouts for rent, and
so
now you're talking 1,800.
More.
And I mean, I remember even moving to Dublin, I mean, in the, like, what's it, 2008 or something, paid about 1,200, and it was expensive at that time to pay that. So it's very, very quickly that the rates have come up. Also as well, I mean, in terms of, like, rents being stabilised in Dublin. They say that, the, according to a DAF.ie report, the rents have pretty much stabilised, but if you live anywhere else in the country, the rents are still going up. And also there's fewer than 1,200 homes available to rent nationwide. So that's what feeds into it, the idea. There's not enough places to live.
18,000 homes on Airbnb and 12,000 to... Yeah. Like, a friend of mine is trying to rent for her family at the minute, and she can't find a home, and she can find 22 Airbnbs around where she's looking.
Yeah, and it feels like the Airbnb issue was particularly big a number of years ago, and it kind of like went under the radar in terms of people's concern about whether that was having an impact. But now I think there's a bit more attention on that, because obviously the government was trying to bring, was bringing in, I suppose, rules around Airbnb. It wasn't like necessarily a crackdown on it, but clearly there are still a lot of places going up in Airbnb that people will be worried about whether or not that affects availability. But I mean, if you live in Dublin, there's slightly more availability because of you know, less jobs in the tech industry at the moment, you know, because of the issues going on there. But I mean, across the board,
across the across the outside of Dublin, because Dublin, you say, is stabilizing, but there's been a 10.7 increase around the country.
Around the country,
as well.
Now,
what, like, is this, sorry, about windfall taxes in the banking sector as well? Because we're seeing banks are hitting mega profits as well, 87 million this year.
Yeah.
Bank of Ireland, AIB, Permanent TSB. Back at 2007 level.
Yeah, so Jed Nash at the TD is saying that. So he's basically saying that the profits at AIB, Bank of Ireland, Permanent TSB, back up at 2007 levels. And there's a banking levy that's already in place for about 9 years. So that's supposed to kind of earn, or kind of raise about 150 million from the banks, or could be billion, maybe I've got it wrong there, from the banks every year. Million, it generated 87 million this year. He's saying that this banking levy should be kept.
Should be like
now,
a win,
They're having consultation basically on that this year. They've asked the public whether or not this banking levy should be kept, because it's kind of take some of those profits off the banks. But it's clearly not making a massive difference at the moment. So I think the idea of having the public consultation will decide whether or not they do more.
Well, that's particularly when the rate of interest for people getting mortgages and getting on
so
to
that's
the
rising
housing sector as well. It's all rising.
Exactly.
Too.
They're making billions, and I think the government will point to a global problem. Like, we've seen the most, no one's buying homes in the UK anymore because of their interest rates. The interest rates here are incredibly high. Trying to buy a home at the moment, you're like, sorry, what?
Yeah.
The mortgage, how much it's gone up. But the thing is, like, it's not working. The country is broken. And I do think that as we get closer and closer to a general election, people are going, well, do we have to give Sinn Féin a go? They've never been in. Can they do anything? Can they? Like,
well,
you know?
The thing is that I suppose the different parties are going to promise a lot about what they're going to do when you're coming up to to elections. And you have people like the OTDs and the Rural Independence Group who are saying, you know, a big thing for them is mortgage interest relief. So you're going to see more and more talk about it as the budget comes up. You're going to see more talk too. I suppose I always feel like it's not till you actually see the people in government that you can see what they actually do. There tends to be a bit of a gap between the promises and what happens, the reality of it. But I do think you will see, like you're suggesting there, the housing issue being very high.
Yeah, well, I mean, they're saying their rates rise above 4% here in Ireland, but over in the UK, I think they're over 5%.
Oh, yeah. It's
for interest.
Yeah, we're almost getting away with it. It's actually crazy that becomes like a normal thing. 4% is fine because it's worse, but a lot of pressure on people.
We'd love to hear from you this morning on that. Of course, you might be able to get a home yourself, or you've got someone living with you and you're like, it's just so broken. 0896111111. We'd love to hear from you.
Let's move on to RTE then as well. So it's now come out that 4 in 10 are not paying the licence fee.
Yeah.
40% is pretty high number, to be honest with you. But given the coverage it had for those couple of weeks, people are obviously really questioning whether they feel it's worthy.
Yeah, I mean, we saw, I think, a lot of speculation about this around the time when there was a controversy over Ryan Turbidy and there was the Oireachtas committee meetings. People were wondering whether or not that would all have a knock-on effect, whether people would say, look, you know, while this is being sorted out, while I'm waiting to see these Grant Thornton report results, for example, I'm not going to pay my my licence fee. It looks like some people potentially have done that. So like you're saying, 4 in 10 are not paying the €160 licence fee. There was about 9,361 licences that were paid in the first 7 days of this month.
Okay.
But if you go back to this week, the same week last year, that number was 15,030. So you can see there's a big gap that's growing there. And I suppose knocking
it's
on from that, people
drop.
Are wondering.
Imagine the money then. That money funds so much of RTE. And unfortunately, that's going to come back and Kevin Backhurst and potentially the government to get that prop up again.
We appreciate that there has been a breach of trust between the public and RTE. That's obvious from the TV licence revenue fall. That's broken. That trust, that's what needs to be fixed. But if people are like, I'm not going to pay that ever. Do you know, if I'm kind of sitting there, if it's a mass revolt, we know it's illegal not to pay your licence fee.
Yeah.
it's going to have to be changed.
It's going to, I mean, it's going to be a big challenge for RT to figure out what to do about this. We're going to see more reports being done, for example, as the Toy Show, the musical. We're going to see the second part of the Grant Thornton report. There's going to be more information that's going to be coming out. But I think people are obviously, some people are biding their time, I suppose, when it comes to this issue and waiting to see what comes out.
Well, I mean, it is law. You are meant to have to pay your licence fee, but you can see just there is that little bit of resentment out there and people are questioning what to do.
They're already putting the boot into Patrick Keilty on the cover of The Sun, wasn't it? And saying Louise Duffy's taking over. Louise, brilliant, love her. Jeannie.
planning, to be fair. I'm not going to get caught in the hop again. let's move on to the story at the front of The Examiner this morning. So, tanning products are putting your health at risk. We did this before, I think, with around a Barbie drug, wasn't it? Around melanotan. So this is obviously
it's still going
in prominence massively as well.
That's the thing. So back in 2017, people were talking about this drug. And then in about 2022, they're talking about this drug. And now it's still going.
So it was huge on TikTok, I remember.
That's it.
The Barbie drug, the Barbie tanning gel. It was like a nasal spray or you could inject it.
Yeah, you can inject it. I mean, those, you know, nasal spray, I mean, if something tells you to inject it, it'll give you a tan. There's your issue. So basically, if people haven't heard about this melanotan too, what it basically does is it encourages your body to create melanin, which changes the colour of your skin. So, I mean, there's a warning, a big warning from the HPRA from Ireland. Now, there was originally a warning in Australia, which is why it initially, I think, came into the news. But the HPRA are basically saying this is not a self-tanning aid, as it's being called in these social media ads. This is medicine. It's actually got another purpose. You shouldn't be taking it. The side effects are really bad. They potentially could lead to melanoma, to skin cancer. It also can lead to muscle tremors, stroke, vision loss. And the idea, I think, when you see something like this, I know on social media, it might seem like, for a tan, it might seem like, you know, it's just some sort of easy product that doesn't have an impact on your body, but it actually changes the way your body functions.
Your cells, it's changes at a cellular level.
Exactly, and it just says a lot, I suppose, of people's like interest and maybe desperation.
Well,
to
we know in Ireland the amount of fake tan that is bought.
At least you can wipe that off, and you have a nice glow. Yeah, like, you know.
But we know the hassle of having to do it as well.
And the state of me not being able to do it. They're like, is she going to come into work? But there's an awful lot of... I was in a shop one day, and all the girls in the shop that work in that shop, they all use sunbeds. They're all in their early 20s. There's a few young ones that work here. They're all on sunbeds. And we're sitting there going, do we not know that you can't be using sunbeds anymore? But there's a huge amount of people using them. They're all booked out, you were saying.
They're still open.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if...
Matt.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, the thing is that, like, it feels like for our generation, that idea of using sunbeds, we kind of know it can be connected to skin cancer.
Yeah.
I had basal cell carcinoma on my face, so I can't go near
that
anything
is a skin
like
cancer.
That. That's skin cancer, yeah, on your face. It's not non-melanoma, so it's not as bad. But that idea of, like, we know that...
It's not that bad.
I mean, I wouldn't advise you getting it, and that's why I don't tan. And I didn't really tan anyway, but sure, it's a long story. But that idea, I think a lot of people did know who were growing up in like the 2000s would have known the connection. But it is interesting to see that generation gap. And it is a serious thing if you are going to be tanning a lot and you don't protect your skin. It can result in, and it really is, you don't want to have to go through the treatment. It really does.
Stick to just the tan you stick in your, you rub in your arms.
Stick to the fake tan. It makes you look lovely.
Particularly if you're going to head down to Killorgan this weekend as well. That's all kicking off. The pub fair is going to kick off.
Oh, there's going to be so much tan at the bug fair.
Fair play. Everybody's going to look very glam at the bug fair. So I always find this story interesting because you've got the goat, King Puck, taken off a mountain, a wild goat, doesn't know what's happening to him, and then he's put up, as is tradition, and held up above the town. And every year there is.
There's the Puck himself, the crown on.
Handsome Puck, wondering, where am I? What's happening?
Why am I being put up on scaffolding?
This year he's not being put up on scaffolding because they're like, he's he's going up, but he's not staying up there for 3 days.
No, he's going up, but he's maybe
quickly.
Not... Quickly. 3 hours?
Sorry, see, my mom
That's
is...
even more of a shock.
See, I go to this this is where I grew up in my childhood. What I find weird and no one seems to talk about is that a primary school girl is the queen of Puck Fair. She's married to the goat, lads. There's no one
That is a slightly more unusual aspect of this whole thing, that a 12-year-old is crowned the queen.
Traditions are fun. aren't they?
And you traditionally always buy a watch at it. Is that not what you do?
I do always buy a watch at the Book Fair. Thank you.
Listen, Aoife Barry, thank you very much. Will you be going to the Book Fair? Have you ever been?
I've never been, no.
It's amazing.
Okay, maybe this will be my year.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one.
Amazing.
Great to have you with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Beautiful Isle of Killorgland. It's going to be a fun weekend. Thank you so much, Aoife Barry. 0896-111-111 to get in contact with us. Now, coming up, we're finding out how a burglary turned into a dinner date.
Yes,
like
we have a roundup of the trending viral news stories all coming up after the break. Wacky.
Now it's time to bring you up to speed on stories that you might have missed from around the world.
But you don't want
to
miss them.
We are everywhere.
Because they're so good. Here to explain is News Talk's Sean Defoe. Good morning, Sean. How are you?
How are you?
I love this. I love when we do these mad things. Can we go to Japan first?
Yes.
What's going on with this fella in
Japan? Someone called Toko. And Toko's decided he'd rather be a dog.
Who wouldn't?
As you do.
You know, some days you just wake up and you go, do you know, I'd prefer to be a dog.
I want a belly rub.
Yeah.
Is that it?
He said he wrote in his yearbook, you know, or one of those, whatever, when you were a kid and you were saying, I want to be a fireman, I want to be a policeman, I want to be an astronaut. He was like, I'd like to be a dog.
Okay.
So it's been a lifelong dream for him that he wants to do it. And he has spent 14,000 euro in a round to create this.
Is that him there?
That's him.
That's him.
That is... Go with the little wave.
Oh my God!
So what has he done?
No, I deliberately didn't want to see this video. So this is him.
So he is. No, he hasn't like surgically changed himself, just to fully clarify, because that's exactly what I thought
had happened.
That's a costume that he had specially made by this company that does a lot of movie props. And that he can just fit into. He said he wanted to be a collie because it was around the right size for a human.
Does he go out and about? What do other dogs make of it? Other dogs have smell. The smell is the thing, isn't it?
The other dogs are totally freaked.
Oh, he's not a great walker now, is he?
He's an older dog. He's an older dog, Jerry. How does he go to the toilet, Tommy wants to know
how he goes to the toilet.
He hasn't clarified
it.
I'm not sure is he bare naked.
There's a little
underneath
zip
there.
Underneath, Tommy, that he opens.
Okay. So is he living as this? Is he doing it for a few hours a day? What do
we know?
He's
doing it for a bit a day. So one of his mates who takes him out for a walk so that he has a human with him when he goes out to the park and all that sort of stuff. But he said at first he was afraid to do it outside the house because he was afraid of being judged and afraid of people laughing at him.
But he's putting these videos up on his YouTube channel.
He started putting them up on the YouTube. He hasn't revealed who he is, and he says he hasn't told most of his friends that he does this or that this is his dream because he's afraid of being laughed at, basically. But he does it for a couple of hours a day, goes out as a dog, and then when he's around the house just does that. There's little videos of meeting. He says fake dog treats. I have a suspicion that perhaps that's the whole root of this. I actually kind of like dog food a little bit.
Munching on the pedigree show.
Munching on it, going picking up a tennis ball. I'm really not sure what appendage he is. It's the teeth of the costume, but I'm not sure what's
in
there.
But in fairness, the costume's fab.
It's very good.
Very good.
If you're going to spend 14 grand on it, that's 14 grand.
I can see Ellen Hughes going, can I rent it for the panto season?
A dog's going into panto Christmas. Even though we don't need one.
He'll fly you over. So he's living like this and he's happy as Larry. He's not doing harm to anyone. And we know that people cosplay all the time, right? Mm. We've seen Comic-Con. People like to dress up as Marvel and DC characters. This is just his thing.
Yeah, that's what lots of people are saying online. They're like, you know, if it's his thing, it's his thing. If that's what you get off. And then some other people are like, it's definitely must be a sex thing. Or some people will pay $14,000 on a dog costume rather than go to therapy, was one of the comments under it. So, you know, people have different takes.
Happening in Japan, not surprising. That's all I'd say. It feels like the right place to do.
Whatever he wants to do.
Exactly. As long as it's not illegal, not hurting anyone.
Privacy of your own home and dog park, you can do what you like.
Dog park as well.
Now, a slightly more serious story about this man in Florida. Tell us about this.
Yeah, so this is a man who, I suppose the dangers of actually going out fishing. He was out fishing in a flat-bottom boat, so wasn't meant to be going out very far in the States, in California, and a 25-year-old. And he was basically swept out to sea. Big tide kind of came along, big wave, knocked him off the boat. And he spent, I think it was 30 hours.
Yeah.
Basically lost at sea. But the ingenuity is kind of what impressed me about this guy. So he, if you see the photos of him, completely baked, head to toe, totally utter red, really bad sunburn.
Charles Gregory is his name.
But you can see it there now, really, really bad burn all over, as well as getting sort of hypothermic conditions in the nighttime while he was there. But he managed to take the engine out of the boat to sort of keep it afloat. And that's how they found him. He also took off his swimming shorts, obviously put them back on there, to wave down boats and passing helicopters just to get any sort of attention. So during during his time, he prayed to God more than he ever had in the rest of his life, but also was stung several times jellyfish.
And sharks.
Also saw sharks, yeah, off the coast. So it's one of those ones where, God, could you imagine where your headspace would go if you were trapped for that?
Because I was just thinking, why didn't he just maybe try and get into the water more? But then if there's sharks and jellyfish around, what do you do? Is it the sunburn or the sharks and jellyfish, you know?
Pick your poison, absolutely. Pick your poison, try and hop on it and maybe keep it. And especially if you thought the boat was going down, you know, he's trying to ditch things off it to sort of keep it afloat. One of the remarkable stories, there's a whole load of these at the moment. There was another one recently from this guy took off from Mexico in a catamaran. With his dog. The engine was knocked off about 3 weeks into the voyage. He spent 2 months drifting. And just literally nothing there.
Did you see him? Like planes or
Middle of nowhere. He was on the way to one of these islands in the Pacific and there was absolutely nothing. Eventually it was a tuna trawler completely by chance came across him and he'd been living for 2 months by literally just fishing off the side of the boat, him and the dog.
The fish.
And eating raw fish. That's how he'd survive. And collecting rainwater that came down onto the catamaran.
Yeah, it was amazing. And everyone, like the dog was just, and kept him. He'd like always praise the dog for keeping him going.
For keeping him sane as well.
It's amazing.
You know? And then he also was giving up obviously enough fish to keep the dog alive. So he was kind of putting enough
in his
body.
It's so sweet. So he's doing fine. He's fine.
God, he's getting all the treatment.
Those stories are incredibly scary because you think like that could happen. Mm. Now let's talk about this.
Only in America.
Okay, we're going to a burglary, and this is in America.
Attempted.
two different ones.
Sorry.
Two different ones. Mm. So the first one, again, involves a dog. And this is exactly what my dog would do, by the way, if we were burgled. Our dog is a great alarm. If someone if I touch the key to the front door, he's off. He's blah, 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 blah. But if anyone came in, he'd literally just roll over and be like pets. And this is what happened in the States, this particular burglary. It was a golden retriever. And this guy comes in. He's going to steal the bike.
The dog starts jumping up at him, going, hello.
Vicious attack dog goes at him here. The best thing, and you won't hear this in the audio, is the guy stops his burglary, puts the bike back, then to pet him and starts going, oh, you're such a good boy. Where's your daddy? Your daddy shouldn't leave the garage door open, should he? Daddy, is anyone home? And all the while petting
this dog.
Best dog.
I just have to go and rob a bike here. So you stay there for a second.
No, you stay. I'm just going to take this quite valuable electric bike. Tell your dad not to do it again.
Yeah. endorphin rush, petting the dog and robbing a bike.
That's great day for that guy.
And let's talk about this woman. She's 87 years old.
Amazing. This is such like stereotypical American 87-year-old woman, a line dancing teacher. And she hears this noise at like 2 a.m. and someone is taking out her, you know, those air conditioning.
Terrifying.
Could be. Absolutely terrifying. Do you know those air conditioning units they had to kind of wedge between the windows over there? Someone had taken that out and it was a 19-year-old who used to mow her lawn. And she came across him and he goes, I'm going to cut you. And she was, her exact quote is, oh, well, if he's going to cut me, I'm going to kick him back. And so this sort of scuffle ensues where this 87-year-old woman is kicking this 19-year-old lad and using the chair. Eventually, he gets tired rather than her because of all the line dancing, I assume. But it comes out that he's actually just starving. He was really, really hungry. And that's what he said. He was like, I was just looking for a bit of food.
So she feeds him.
Crackers.
And she said, you're not well, obviously not well.
You're obviously not well. Yeah. Crackers, peanut butter, mandarins, all this sort of stuff. And while he was eating, she then called the police and got them around. So she has since been given a baseball bat by her neighbours and had the thing more securely reinstalled, the air conditioning. But yeah, went from breaking in and I'm going to hurt you to here, have a cracker while I call the police.
Yeah. The ingenuity of it. Also, someone's just starving and you have to feed them. It's terribly sad. Your podcast, Let Me Explain, this week is dealing with something we're talking about at 8:15. This is the Dying with Dignity.
Yeah, the Dying with Dignity legislation. And it's something I've been kind of covering for a while, obviously, since the Oireachtas Committee came up. And a couple of months ago, I chatted to a man called Brendan Clark and we had a really kind of interesting, really passionate chat about his life. He was living with motor neuron disease and talking about the need for the legislation when you don't have a way out, when you have a fatal diagnosis. And look, unfortunately, Brendan died last week. He died on Thursday. He was a fan of Ireland AM. He used to watch you, text me when I was on the show. And, you know, we've been texting back and forth since then. He was just a lovely man and, you know, would want to pay tribute to what he called Bren's Angels, who were his support group. Like, his phone was ringing off the hook even while we were interviewing for people. So, look, it was a really passionate interview. We only played some of it on the radio. And today I just kind of wanted to put the full thing out on the podcast, Let Me Explain. So it's available now. As you said, really important issue to be thinking about and sort of thinking about him today. Just a really interesting discussion.
And his family, because it's just a heartbreaking condition that's happening. The Let Me Explain podcast is available now. You're one, and we will be talking about that legislation, the proposed legislation coming up about 8:15 on the show today. Sean Defoe, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure having
you
here.
Thank you.
But before that, we'll have the latest on what to watch after the break. Well, you're very welcome back. Now, from murderous mayhem, good way to start, to hurtful home truths, there's been a mixed bag of what to watch this weekend.
And here to give us his famed, honest opinion is entertainment.ie's Brian Lloyd. That's you.
Hi.
He's going to go for it.
Yeah.
You always love to go for it.
We love your opinions, Brian.
We do. What are we talking? The first thing we're talking about today is Haunted Mansion. What's this?
Yes.
Where can we watch it?
So this is a... Yeah, did you just like...
Haunted... Like, it's been such a rich vein of form for movies recently.
Yes. Yeah.
Haunted Mansion doesn't really...
No.
Tell us what it is about.
So it is based on the Disney park ride. If you've ever been to Disneyland, you made that face.
Yeah.
You said ride.
Well, Pirates of the Caribbean.
Pirates of the Caribbean, yeah. They do, some of them work. This doesn't, though, unfortunately. And, like, there was one a few years back, if you remember, with Eddie Murphy. The look of just completely, huh?
No.
Yeah, no. It's grand. It wasn't good, and this one isn't good either. That's all you need.
Okay, well, we do have a little clip of it. Let's take a little look.
Pumpkin, what's wrong?
This place is haunted!
All right, now, hang on. Now, I know this place isn't as warm as I'd hoped, but, you know, I think we get some daylight in here, it's gonna feel better. Hey, I'm gonna light a vanilla candle, and it's gonna be a game changer.
Will it, though?
That's how I feel when I light a vanilla candle.
I feel
like Gwyneth Paltrow.
That's
like,
it.
Look how fancy I am.
So it's PG-13.
Yes.
It is kind of for a younger family audience, and there's a great cast in it.
There is, yeah. So you have Rosario Dawson, you have Jamie Lee Curtis, you have Danny DeVito, you have Owen Wilson, you have Lakeith Stanfield.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, no, it is. It's a big ensemble, and Tiffany Haddish as well. So you have a big, like, ensemble cast. The problem with it is that, like, it's not really funny and it's not really scary. And that's, I mean, as much as it is kind of PG-13 and, you know, you think of something like Hocus Pocus, for example, they can be kind of fun.
Yeah.
If this was released 30 years ago around the same time as Hocus Pocus, you probably would be, it would be a bit more, I kind of guess, funnier or whatever. You'd be a bit more kind of used to it. But now you watch and it's like, It's a little bit tedious, it's a bit meh.
So even, you don't even think children might be a bit bored by this?
Children might be a bit bored by it, yeah. I don't know. I mean, I don't have kids, obviously. But, like, I would imagine kids would probably find this a little bit meh. I mean, they'd be better off seeing, like, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Oh, much better.
There we go.
Okay, so it is in cinemas. How do you rate it?
Like, 2 out of 5.
2 out of 5.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So we're going to move on to a film that I have been looking forward to. This is called You Hurt My Feelings. What's this about?
So this is on Amazon Prime. This stars Julie Louis-Dreyfus and it's written and directed by Nicole Holofcener. Now, she did a film about 10 years ago called Enough Said, which was this brilliant comedy drama with James Gandolfini. This is a similar vibe as well. She plays an author who is working on her first fiction book. She's having trouble with it. Her agent rejects it. And then her husband is out one day and she kind of creeps up behind him and hears him talking about it. And he hates it.
Oh, it's just like, no.
And like, that's the thing about this kind of film is that when you're watching it, like, it's very, very relatable. Like, I'm sure we've all had kind of moments of unguarded honesty. And then somebody walks in and you're like, oh, hey, who are you?
We weren't meant to hear that.
Oh, yeah. No, I love that thing. Yeah. And that's really what the film is about. It's the idea of like how... I suppose, like, the little white lies that people kind of tell each other to kind of smooth the waters and keep everything kind of... I mean, certainly I was watching it and I related to a lot of things because...
Husband in this is Tobias Menzies, who Outlander fans will absolutely love. Let's take a quick look at You Hurt My Feelings.
So, Elliot tells me you're a writer.
In your last one, it should have done better.
There's lots of new voices. Refugees, cancer, murder, abuse.
I'm an old voice.
You're the best voice.
Maybe if Dad hadn't just been verbally abusive, it would have been a bestseller.
Don't say that.
Your memoir is great. Your new book is great.
How are you?
Feeling a little off my game.
The only reason she makes me a salad is because she wants me to lose weight, which is passive aggressive.
No, I want you to be healthy.
Doesn't matter.
Can you shut up and keep talking?
Don, you want to intervene here? We can do this at home.
Maybe Milani looks tired.
I'm aging.
What are you, nuts?
You get Botox.
Well, I just get a little bit right here. You know, I can still move my eyebrows. Watch.
so expressing.
Yeah, like it's that kind of thing. Like it's about the kind of, I suppose, the lies that tell. Like it's a very grown-up comedy. Like, and yeah. I don't mean in the sense of like it's explicit or anything like that. But it kind of deals with very adult themes, yeah. like getting older, recognizing that you're not looking your best anymore, and then even kind of like hitting the midpoint in your career, and you're kind of starting to reassess everything. So I really enjoyed this. I thought it's really worth the watch, and it's on, like I said, it's on Prime Video, and it's 90 minutes long.
It's 90
oh,
minutes.
Wow. Love it.
Right, there you go. The minute you say 90 minutes, you're like, perfect.
Not a 3-hour slog. Okay, brilliant.
And the people who were in it, we just saw David Cross and Amber Tamblyn, who are real-life husband and wife, playing a couple in therapy, and it's just got nice little things.
Yeah, it's that lovely kind of like, yeah, like you see little lovely little scenes like that, and like people turn up, like you saw like Jeannie Burland there, and then Michaela Watkins is in it as well. So like, yeah, it's really enjoyable.
It makes me think of kind of This Is 40.
Exactly like that.
Do you mean whenever you're kind of like real life issues of what it's actually like.
Yeah. That's grown very up movie.
Yeah, grown up movie. Yeah, like Annie Hall or like any of those kind of things. Yeah, worth the watch.
God, this
brilliant.
Is so nice.
Brilliant. Okay, what do you give it out of
like
5?
Like 3.5 out of 5. Like, okay. It's worth the watch, yeah.
Lovely.
Worth watching for the weekend.
Now, we're going to talk about a programme that has been such a massive hit in its first 2 series.
Yeah.
It is back. It's Only Murders in the Building.
Yeah, so this is on Disney Plus from, you know, I want to say. Okay. But yeah, so it's Steve Martin, Martin Short and Selena Gomez. They're back. They play this podcast hosts who each season they investigate a murder that happens in their building, but this time around it actually happens in a theatre, and the special guest stars are Meryl Streep and Paul Rudd.
Oh wow.
Which, yeah, that's it. Like, it kind of speaks to how popular the show has become, that they can attract that kind of talent. Martin Short is a theatre director in it, and he's getting his first show back after like years in the wilderness. And Meryl Streep is this actor that he casts in it, who's like spent years being a terrible actor. Well, not a terrible actor, but she's just never gotten her chance. And this is her first show, whereas Paul Rudd is this Hollywood star type.
Brilliant.
Who is trying to, you know, get artistic credibility by doing a theatre show. It's brilliant. This is so well written. This is so well done. Like, the chemistry that they all have together, it's really noticeable. And it's funny.
Should you watch the first 2 seasons before going straight to 3rd?
I would, because they're really good.
They're really good. Okay.
They're actually really worth watching. Like, it's the kind of thing, like, if you end up watching this 3rd one, you don't need to have seen the first 2. Yeah. But it would help.
It's just so enjoyable. Let's take a quick look at Only Murders in the Building.
It's opening night, and a big star drops dead on stage.
Oh my God, my leading man is dead.
Is this really happening?
Well, you know, who are we without a homicide?
NYPD, the killer is someone in this room.
My show is hanging on by a thread here.
Finding this killer is the only way you'll have a show. Want to make a podcast with me?
Oh my God, this is corny.
So corny.
I know it is. Yeah. Murder?
Yeah, murder.
It is so good. Yeah. It's a joy to watch. And in this, Meryl Streep, obviously being Meryl Streep, she has to do bad acting at one stage,
which is really difficult.
Yeah, and she's so good at it.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, she's playing like a, she plays like a bad actor in it, and that's like, it's like a really good singer trying to bad sing. Like, they can't do it. Like,
she's mesmerizing.
Okay. Great.
It's amazing.
I started off pretty not impressed, but I think those last 2 definitely go watch them as well. What are you going to give? Sorry, can you give us ratings?
Yeah, like 4 out of 5. Like, it's worth a watch. Totally worth a watch.
Brilliant.
Yeah, definitely. That's Disney Plus coming on Friday.
Yep.
Brian Lloyd from entertainment.ie, as always. Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Still to come this morning, we're cooking up a flowery feast. Wait until you get a load of this cake. It is beautiful. That's coming up in the Ireland AM kitchen very shortly.
And going golfing with broadcasters Pamela Joyce and Lorraine Keane. See you in 4.
Oh no. They don't thump.
Good morning, you're very welcome back to Ireland. And we've still got loads coming up this hour. Very shortly, we're going to be discussing end-of-life care in Ireland with advocates who are calling for a change in assisted dying legislation. That's coming up at 8:15. We'd love to get your opinion on it. 0896 111 111. Do you agree or do you not? And at 9:20, broadcasters Pamela Joyce and Lorraine Keane show us how to make the cut with the perfect putt. Yes, we're going golfing at 9:20. Look forward to that. Now, outside Tim Warren, what have we got coming up, Warren?
Green fingers, green fingers, green fingers. Our green thumbed goddess, Catherine Carton, is here. You're going to show us how to grow our own herb garden.
Yeah, so I constructed a little herb garden for you.
What's she done? Made this. This is so cool.
So whether you have like a big space or a small space, you can definitely grow them on, you know, balconies and patios. So you don't have to have a huge garden if you want to make a little herb garden.
Like if like I've got you barely can... any space whatsoever. Like I mean, it's
yeah,
this
you
big.
Can pop
you
some
could
herbs
do this.
In that. Absolutely, yeah. And herbs, once they get going, they're really low maintenance as well.
And it's the sort of thing we all need a bit of basil in the house to get rid of the flies at the minute.
Yeah.
But this smells gorgeous.
Yeah. So you can even drink some of this. It's not just for cooking as well. You can pop this in a little mojito.
Every time she's in, it's like therapy. It's just so relaxing. And then she mentions mojitos. It's a beautiful thing. Catherine, thank you so much for that. And now Alan is also, we're keeping on theme here. He's having some floral fun in the kitchen.
We are, Mirren, but what's that behind you?
What's behind
what's
me?
Behind
God, you're
you?
All about the panto today. That's for the golf.
The golf coming up later on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. Do you not know that's what a golf course looks like, Alan?
a big black thing. Yeah. Yes, flower power has spread into the kitchen as well, and we're here. What are we making, Erin? Because this looks absolutely gorgeous.
So today I'm going to be talking about how you can use edible flowers, many of which are probably already grown in your garden, like lavender and cornflowers and marigolds and things like that, and how you can press them and use them basically to decorate a beautiful celebration cake with buttercream and jam filling in the middle. This is lemon and blackcurrant, so.
It just looks absolutely stunning. Looking forward to that. That's coming up a little later on. Get the kettle on. We're having cake at half eight.
Cake and tea.
Yeah,
delicious.
Cake and tea.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
This morning we'll see a good deal of cloud at first with limited sunny spells and possible patchy drizzle and mist and fog most prevalent in southern areas with patchy light rain at times. Some better sunny spells will develop through the morning but becoming breezy as moderate to fresh southeasterly winds develop. This afternoon then showery rain will push into the west and southwest extending northeastwards through the rest of the day, turning heavy at times with highest temperatures of 18 to 23 degrees. Showery rain will clear northeastwards through the first half of the night as moderate to fresh southeasterly winds ease for a time, allowing mist and hill fog to form. Clear spells and showers will follow from the southwest and the winds will increase towards morning with overnight temperatures between 12 and 15 degrees.
Chill insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
It's time now to take a look at this morning's paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline, TDs call for mortgage relief as rates rise above 4%. Independent TDs are demanding action ahead of the budget to help struggling homeowners after interest rate rises.
NCT calls in Gardaí over broker site offering test dates. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. A British website claiming to be an intermediary has been offering slots for car tests in Ireland, charging over €130 for booking and the test.
The Examiner leads with UHL staff fear winter collapse. The staff of University Hospital Limerick has said that they are increasingly fearful about what the winter will bring as they struggle to cope with overcrowding already in August. Yesterday, the hospital had 100 people on trolleys waiting for beds.
Taoiseach, we face a new wave of COVID is the top story on the Daily Mail. The number of people in hospital with the virus has more than tripled in the last 2 weeks.
The Mirror goes with panic station. Official figures show that nearly 4 in 10 people were not paying for their TV licence fee.
The Sun leads with Duffy's Late Wait Show. Former Today FM presenter Louise Duffy has been considered as the first female host of the Late Late Show after Patrick Kielce's run ends in 3 years.
The Star leads with El Chapo, the morning to you. Dual Mexican-Irish citizen Maris O'Shea Salazar has been named in a South American court as a key player in El Chapo's cartel.
And finally, the Herald goes with when Porsche comes to shove. A 21-year-old man allegedly dragged the owner of a Porsche 911 from his sports car in South Dublin before driving it erratically around the city, causing €60,000 worth of damage.
Isn't that gas? Patrick Kilty hasn't even started the gig.
I know.
And they're lining up his replacement.
Like, I get paranoid when I take time off, but Janie, Patrick hasn't even sat in the
best
chair.
Best of luck, Louise, if that's already in talks with...
In talks with management and RTE.
But 3 years to come up with your contract is good.
Well, speaking of RTE, and one of the newspaper headlines was that 4 in 10 are not paying their licence fee. Which is pretty a big number, and
huge.
I'm sure like the amount of money that is going to cost RTE is huge. But Martin has said, sitting at breakfast table at work, 3 out of 6 people don't pay it or haven't paid it. I was biting my tongue. The licence fee should be part and parcel of living in this country, despite all the controversy attached to RTE.
Well, Miriam, what's your famous line? How much is it a day?
41 cent a day 41 is what cent you pay for.
That's how much it is. That's outrageous.
Raging, so it is.
Look what Fred said. No, it is. You are supposed to pay.
The website.
It
or
is
the radio. I think most people in this country would be using the app or the
because they're too busy watching us in the morning.
Yeah, apart from that, Fred says, I will refuse to pay the licence fee until more comes out about this scandal. I cannot bring myself to give RTE any more money until there is a resolution to this task.
Yeah, well, you know, I don't know when we're ever going to see that.
No, well...
Well, I suppose whether more is going to be uncovered about how the unions operate inside there, what's actually going on. There's a lot more, I'd say, we'll find out.
Have you ever dressed up, Tommy? Have you ever dressed up in a costume?
I love Halloween dressing up, yeah.
Oh, there's something more about it.
Would you pay for an outfit?
That rugby team used to do some mad stuff, I'd say.
Would you pay 15 grand to buy a costume?
Isn't that if you felt like a dog, why not?
Well, if you want to go around like this, have a look at this. That's actually a man in a costume.
Yes.
Look at him.
Hi. Give us the paw.
So a man in Japan pays $15,000 to turn himself into a dog.
And Niall just says, lads, I've seen it all. Your man is barking mad. How can you justify 15 grand on a dog suit? There's a lot of people that need friends to slag you and tell you to cop on. Sure, look, do you know, people spend golf memberships.
Sean Defoe earlier on. You just wanted to know how he went to the loo, Tommy.
Well, that's it. Does he go on the side of the dog's wheel or the car's wheel?
Is that his hip? Is that how he's walking?
Obviously his hands and his two arms are at the front.
Or is that his knee? I can't really work it out.
Like the back bit.
I can't work it out. And also, we did have another story today. Jack Horgan-Jones was talking about the average rent. It's hit €1,800 and TD's called for mortgage relief. Rachel says, housing is definitely broken in this beautiful country. I'm from and living in Wicklow, although couldn't afford to live in the town I was born and reared in. Wicklow now officially the dearest place to find a home. The issue in between. Yeah, it is. It's gone up the most. I can't afford Dublin. I can't afford Wicklow. When will it end? And how remote do I have to live?
Back to the dog. Is he on his knees? Or is he on his feet, though? I mean, how does he do it?
I thought we had to get one in. Sorry, Anne, our floor manager, is trying behind the camera. Can we throw a camera around to her? No?
Look at lads. Have you let us know if you have
Come
ever...
on, Anne. No, what do you...
Anne's doing the dog.
What do you do?
Oh, that's the way you do it.
No, but can you walk?
Walk.
Yeah. But he goes for an hour walk. Could you do that for an hour, Anne?
Anyway,
listen.
We'll get you some dog
food. Have you ever dressed up? Have you ever wanted to be a dog? Have you ever wanted to do anything like that?
Her knees are gone.
Let us know. We'd love to hear from you.
Anyway.
Yeah, what's the best costume you've ever been in? Have you got a picture of you in a costume?
We have.
Send them in to us.
Yeah, 0896111111. We have lots more coming up here in Ireland M after this short break.
Catch you in a minute.
You're very welcome back. Now, voluntary assisted dying gives a person a choice on when they can end their life. It's been introduced in many countries across the world, but in Ireland, it is still illegal.
Now we hear from two people whose personal experiences caused them to advocate for better legislation in the area. Please welcome probate law solicitor Justin McKenna and chairperson of End of Life Ireland, Janie Lazar. Thank you both so much for being with us this morning. We really do appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Janie, how did you get involved with this movement? Because I know that you've battled cancer twice yourself.
Yes.
And then there was someone in your life who had motor neuron disease.
That's right. Very different. My Roland Evans, he was diagnosed and he lived a lot longer than many with motor neuron. Mm. But I lived with them for 6 months and it was when I was renovating my cottage. So I live with them and really, really saw the impact of what an incurable condition can do. And we had many, many discussions. He was quite frank about things. He said, it is insupportable the way in which I will die.
Mm. I mean, voluntary assisted dying, it is, as we just mentioned, they're legal in many countries around the world. Can you explain to us a bit how it happens?
It's different in each country.
Okay.
But essentially, the guidelines are drawn up. There's a framework of safeguards to obviously protect everyone, not just the vulnerable. Mm. But usually what happens is that there are two doctors who are assessing a patient. And quite often in countries like New Zealand, what could happen is that if somebody they don't feel is ready at an advanced enough stage, they will then revisit with that patient. But essentially, there's a very strong guideline and training for doctors who are obviously providing this service. And it is a service.
Well, it's important to say, to use the word voluntary in relation to this, because I know that this can be sensationalised in such a way that it's like, well, this is just getting people off the health system's books in various countries. You've heard those arguments. But we'll dig into that in just a minute. But Justin, you're a probate solicitor, so you have been around the issue of end of life and people dying all of your professional life. But you did get personally involved with this as well when your lovely wife, Claire, she was diagnosed with motor neuron disease.
Just 4 years ago, 2019. And whereas I've been involved in end-of-life work for over 45 years, it was always on my mind that things should be a little bit fair at the end, because it's something I do and I talk about. But then she was diagnosed just 4 years ago, and so I had to face it, obviously. It was motor neuron is one of those things that requires care. So I had to give up the job to look after her. And then COVID happened. So it was quite traumatic, all told, and quite an experience. But it reinforced my own thoughts at the end when she wanted to finish things and we couldn't really have that conversation. That wasn't really an option. We just had to work with the palliative team, who were unbelievable. That she died in a hospice, and she was in good hands. You know, at the end, she got as good as it gets, as far as the laws are here now, but I think she would have preferred to be at home.
Really? Yeah. So, because she did pass in July 2021.
21, yeah, she had it for 2 years.
But you did discuss this. Is this
not really.
That,
We couldn't. I mean, there was no point.
Yeah.
You can't discuss something that isn't going to happen. And
did you feel that if that had been available, it might have been something that she would have...
There was a point, of course, when, towards the end, she had bulbar, so she lost her speech.
Yeah.
Mm. She lost the power to swallow. She was fed through a peg. And she had this pooling thing that where she couldn't... Where her the natural liquids would start pooling just above her air pipe. So we had to use a pump to push down her throat to collect whatever was there to try and stop her from choking. Very distressing to watch that happen.
Yeah. Mm.
And during the time towards the end, it was for her, it was very, very stressful.
And I think for anyone who has been around someone who is dying of, you know, natural cancers or motor neuron disease towards the end, there's very little dignity in dying. It's a horrific thing to see. But in this country, it is, if you assist someone, it is considered manslaughter.
Yeah.
You know, you will get 14 years in jail. And Justin, like, you're the solicitor here, there would be an awful lot of people who would absolutely think that this was manslaughter if you did, if you medically intervened in a way towards the end to, I might use the words, ease someone's passing to make pain stop, but other people might say, well, that's murder.
The principle may be that way, but I think deep down, most people understand that compassion at the end, you've got to excuse that moment of when you just accelerate somebody's death. And for the person who's suffering, it's all about choice. You don't necessarily have to take that route, but if you have the option of, it's there, it's available, it's something that you could do. In other countries where they've allowed it, and they've prescribed some end-of-life drug, they're very often not used. They don't take advantage of it.
Okay. Janie, because it is a divisive issue, and I'm sure you've had a lot of people speak out against it, what are their main issues? Is it religious, or do they have other moral objections to it? What have you heard?
It's in the main, it tends to come from a religious belief.
Okay.
That life is precious and it should be preserved at all costs.
But an awful lot of people who would sit here and they'd argue against something like the death penalty, saying no one has a right to choose who lives or dies. That is not within our power as human beings. And it shouldn't be within our power. And they could sit here and go, well, this is, you know, they could relate it to eugenics, going, well, who do you think you are to take someone's life that has to take its natural course?
But my response to that really is, if somebody is dying and they're in incredible either pain or under great stress, they're very anxious and increasingly losing control of all of their faculties in terms of physical abilities, why would you unnecessarily... why would you deny another person the choice? Mm-hmm. Why would you allow... different interventions to happen when somebody wants to die? They've reached a point of no return. They're in incredible pain. Why would you prolong that period of suffering?
Is there a worry that for some people, and of course we're saying that this is a choice of the person who is in this pain and it is an end-of-life intervention, but could there be an argument, like with all things, that somehow there will be someone who interferes and does take advantage of the system to get an older person out of their life so they can get the will, so they can get what's there? You know, that this could be corrupted, Justin.
We have a piece of legislation that has gone through called the Assisted Decision-Making Capacity Act. That's now coming into force. It has since
started.
April. And within that, the protocols around that piece of legislation, you've got all kinds of... protections. You've got the decision support service now as a separate office available to monitor and to look after decisions that are made where capacity is in question. And if somebody then argues that there was an element of coercion or undue influence, then we already have in place the legislation to take care of that. Okay. So that there's a process.
Okay.
You have to go through a period of notifications and so on.
So it is with the Oireachtas at the minute, and they are going through what safeguards need to be in place to potentially move this forward. What way do you see that at the moment? And even what are the laws around end of life at the minute?
Well, at the moment, end of life is categoric. Section 2 of the Suicide Act of 1993 says it's murder. So you've got to, if you aid, abet, or procure. The committee that's sitting at the moment is the Joint Oireachtas Committee. It's the culmination of a passage of activity, if you like, in the Oireachtas. And it's due to report in the new year. And they're dealing with expert witnesses who are coming in, discussing all the aspects. And they're coming now, they've left the constitutional legal aspects, and they're going to look at the ethical end of it now in September. So as they do, as they progress, they're learning, and the report that they put together, I'm quite certain, will say, OK, let's do it, but let's put in the safeguards.
Yes, absolutely. That is, and I know that you're advocating for that so much. So Portugal, I think, they're bringing it into legislation. Mm-hmm. France, UK, Germany are all looking at it at
the
minute.
They're looking at it.
Is
it in New Zealand, Australia as well at the moment?
Yes.
Yeah, and of course Switzerland, Dignitas, which would have been the one we would have all known about. I suppose it's a weird thing to be hopeful for, isn't it? But at the same time, if anyone's watched someone die, it's a horrible thing to do.
It is, and the way the way I'd respond to that is, it is a valid end-of-life choice and a kinder death is possible for those who would choose it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's very, very interesting. We're really interested to see how that will progress over the next number of months as well. Janie Lazar, Chair of the End of Life Ireland, thank you so much for coming in. And of course, Justin McKenna, Probate Law Solicitor, thank you so much for coming in
again,
also.
Sorry about
thank
the
you.
Loss of your wife. Like,
thank you very much.
Speak so lovely. And we'd love to hear from you on this, because this is something that affects absolutely everybody. 0896 111 111. It is a very important piece of legislation. We'd love to hear from you.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
This morning we'll see a good deal of cloud at first with limited sunny spells and possible patchy drizzle and mist and fog most prevalent in southern areas with patchy light rain at times. Some better sunny spells will develop through the morning but becoming breezy as moderate to fresh southeasterly winds develop. This afternoon then showery rain will push into the west and southwest extending northeastwards through the rest of the day, turning heavy at times with highest temperatures of 18 to 23 degrees. Showery rain will clear northeastwards through the first half of the night as moderate to fresh southeasterly winds ease for a time, allowing mist and hill fog to form. Clear spells and showers will follow from the southwest and the winds will increase towards morning with overnight temperatures between 12 and 15 degrees.
Chill insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Perfect coffee every time. Tassimo sponsors cookery on Ireland AM.
Now we've a real floral feast in the kitchen this morning.
It's absolutely stunning.
Demolished.
Errand Bunting is going to show us how to ice a lemon and blackcurrant cake with edible flowers. Good morning to you, Errand. Can we just give a moment to this cake?
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
And we've got a nice little segment cut out of it as well.
Look
now
at that.
As well. So
even better again.
Looking pretty good.
Yeah. So they're all flowers that you've pressed.
Yes.
Turn it back around there again because we're close up. Because I think when you look at that inside, like, come on, lads.
Yeah, so they're all flowers that have been pressed. But I was just going to give you a quick rundown on how to make the cake.
Okay.
You can find the recipe for the cake on the website, on your website, the Ireland AM website, or you can see it in our book
on
as well.
Book. Yeah,
so it's basically just like a kind of standard sponge cake. So that's like equal quantities, butter and sugar, cream together, and then you add in your eggs slowly, equal quantity eggs, and then you add in the flour and like loosen it with a bit of milk. And you can add all sorts of flavourings into a cake like that. It's like a standard sponge cake. If you learn that, you'll be able to make a cake anywhere. And I basically make 2 6-inch cakes and then I slice them in half, 6 inches to 15 centimetres. So then I slice them in half and then you can layer them up basically with the buttercream and jam in the middle.
Come on, let's get, like, because this is the really impressive bit.
Come on,
isn't it?
Yeah.
Come on.
So come on, talk about the flowers.
Well, the flowers...
So, for a start, where do you get the flowers?
So we grow the flowers. We have a small holding just outside Belfast in County Down. So we grow lots of vegetables and edible flowers there. So I would say if you're going to use flowers for cakes and things like that, you need to either grow them yourself or you need to buy them from like a reputable supplier who will say that they're suitable for edibles because lots of flowers are sprayed.
Don't
you know,
have pesticides.
Yeah, like to kind of stop them getting like little bugs and things. But probably if you've got a garden and you're growing things already or your parents have a garden or whatever, you'll have loads of little flowers that are...
So what's that, lavender?
So yeah, so like lavender. Loads of people are growing lavender in their gardens.
Yeah, we've got lavender.
This is quite a kind of popular little one as well. This is a pot marigold. Lots of people would grow that like as a bedding plant and things like that. It's a little orange daisy.
What about daisies? Daisies
are all edible. So you could just pick daisies from your lawn, providing...
How do you know what's edible?
Well, I would say you always need to like... you know, get a good book or something that will identify.
Read your book.
Well, my book has like instructions on about 30 edible flowers in there.
With dandelions.
Dandelions are edible as well. They wouldn't press very well because they're quite fleshy. So one of the things about pressing flowers is you want something that's quite kind of like not too kind of fleshy, quite thin, quite light, like little pansies and violas, you know, these type of little flowers, they press really well. Little daisies from your lawn, providing you don't have a dog. Mm. Or whatever.
So you have the daisies there. So what you do, so you go out and you pick your daisies. Yeah. And then what's the next step?
And then, so then what you can do is then you press them.
I've just eaten a daisy. Daisies aren't that...
Did you see one? That's actually a chamomile. Yeah, they definitely have a wee bit of a kind of like bitterness to them.
Oh, they do, don't they?
Really?
Yeah, I got the head of it.
But actually, a little daisy is actually quite a nice light sort of honey flavour. This chamomile, which is Roman chamomile, has a slightly like stronger, more bitter flavour, I would definitely say.
Okay.
So if you want to press them, you basically
It's lovely, I meant to say. Sorry.
You really enjoyed it.
The daisy's gorgeous. After us telling to go out your garden, pick your daisy.
Okay. The dog got that one.
You just need some like standard white paper, you know, like printer paper type thing. And then you can either do this in a flower press. So I've got a flower press that I made here. Or you can do it in a book. So if you don't have a flower press, you want to do it
in any big book.
Big, heavy book, split them. And then you just arrange your flowers like in a little row. Wow. They'll be kind of puffy, obviously, before they're pressed. And then you just put your other bit of paper, and then you either put the bit of cardboard between your flower press and then put your lid or your flower press on, or if you're just putting them in a book.
And how long do you leave it for?
They probably take about 2 weeks to press. It depends on the size of the flowers. So some of the smaller ones, like those little violas, would press in like 5 to 7 days. But bigger flowers, like cornflowers or these calendula, you probably need to put in for 2 weeks.
Well, if you're doing like a summer party or something and you want to do this as a real showstopper in the middle of the table, I mean, it's a great idea.
Or like a wedding cake, if you're doing a little wedding, or like a really nice birthday celebration.
So obviously for them to stick to the cake, the buttercream needs to be just gone on.
So what I do when I'm making this cake is I layer the cake up, and then I do what you call a crumb coat, which is what you would call in the kind of cake decorating world a crumb coat, which is you put a really thin layer of buttercream all over the cake, this, and then you put it in the fridge for an hour or so, and that sets it all up, and it traps all the crumbs inside the icing, then when you do your final layer of buttercream, you don't get all your crumbs kind of stuck into the cake.
So actually, so how much buttercream?
It's a bit warmer than I would like it to be because it's not been in the fridge because we're on the thing. But if you had just come, if it just comes out of the fridge, then
it would normally
just have this like
it,
really smooth layer of buttercream that you can put over the top.
So how much buttercream would you kind of have?
Just like enough to make you're smoothing out all the imperfections on the cake, and you just want to end up with a nice layer of probably about half a centimetre around the side of the cakes or something like that.
And then when you do that, before it sort of hardens up, you start pressing your flowers into it.
Stick
so then you just get your pressed flowers. I'm going to stick a few on here. I'm just going to smooth that wee bit out there.
Look at that.
And if you're doing it, at home, you can spend a bit
and
of time.
And you did this over lockdown as well. It was like a real project for you.
Yeah, so this started... Kind of... So I ran a catering company during lockdown and was running lots of events and doing like lots of outside catering weddings and things like that. And
stick them on.
Basically, just stick it on like that, and you can have it up like a little bit above the top of the cake. Or you can just go for it. You can chop off the ends and have them a bit further down, and they just stick on really easily.
Something different, isn't it?
Yeah,
and like you can pick, all sorts of things like mint as well. This is a wee, mint from your garden. So you can stick those on as well. Mint leaves and things.
That would take a little bit of time, and it's nice to spend a little bit of time doing that.
Yeah, and I sort of like when I'm doing it to try and kind of create this idea that you're sort of making it like a flower garden as though it's quite natural feeling. Yeah. But you could obviously do something more graphic if you wanted to. But like even using these are like little rocket flowers here, and they almost look like little flies.
Yeah, I was going to say that. And what are the flowers on top then, Errand?
So then once I've done the decorating of this, you can then get some like really nice fresh flowers from your garden and use them to decorate. So we've got some dahlias here, which are edible. Lots of people will be growing dahlias. Dahlias are edible, yeah.
Okay.
They have a nice kind of apple-y celery flavour, really good in salads as well. Nasturtiums, I've got little lavenders here. And then there's some mint, and these are lovely, scented leaves. So, you can just arrange a nice little kind of
It's absolutely amazing. If you want to do like a wedding cake or something like
that, special
it's absolutely
for
amazing. If people do want to know a little bit more, and I think it is very important to know what flowers you are putting on your cake as well.
So absolutely.
Good book. Your book, of course, is called The Edible Flower.
Yes, and it's got all the instructions on which flowers are edible and how to grow them as well. If you want to plan ahead for a wedding or something like that, and you think, I'm going to plant my flowers next spring and press them through the summer.
Well, Errand, it looks beautiful, but most importantly, it tastes beautiful.
Would you like another slice of cake?
We'll have another slice.
Tommy. I'm going to get the knife.
Flowers out to Murren. What else have we got coming up?
To our flower, our budding flower.
Thanks so much. Oh, aren't you low? Oh, you're talking about Catherine. Of course you are. Catherine Carton's here. Now, they're eating flowers inside there.
Yeah, and we're going to grow them.
This is what's happening.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to show you next how we can grow things that you can eat. It all makes sense. We'll be back in a minute on Ireland AM.
Perfect coffee every time. Tassimo sponsors Cookery on Ireland AM.
Thanks for staying with us. Now we're getting all green fingered this morning because growing your own produce can not only give you great personal satisfaction, but also can save you a pretty penny.
He's using this, a trowel.
I actually not just, have a trowel.
It's weird.
I have a trowel in hand. I had to ask, what was this?
Did you?
No, I didn't.
No, you didn't. You're just out to prep our very own herb garden. It is gardener Catherine Carton. It is lovely to have you here. And we're going to get stuck in because you built these to kind of show.
Yeah, so I think...
Regardless of your outside space, you can do this.
So if you have like a small garden or you just want a smaller space for growing herbs, you can put them into like these little raised beds or containers.
Okay.
You can use like upcycled buckets and tins. So they'll kind of grow in anything.
And then if you had a little balcony in an apartment, perfect.
Herbs love pots, so you can grow them on walls, you can stick them into terracotta pots, you can grow some indoors as well. So I've made us like a little garden here today just to show you how much you can kind of pack into like a little space. So this isn't that big, but there's lots in it that you can use. I've got like some parsley, I've got some rosemary, got some thyme, have some sage. So there's loads in this that you can use for cooking, but I also have some chives. This is rocket salad.
That's the flower.
Wow.
Sorry.
Okay, if you're starting off, is there some herbs that are so easy to grow that nobody, you can't, because I'm the worst.
How many plants have you got?
I'm just like, I'm terrible.
To kill them, because I have killed a few, they don't like soggy and shade. So when I was on last month and we were chatting about lavender...
But then they don't grow in Ireland.
No, there is still space for them. So think of a sunny spot in your garden. Some people say to grow them near the kitchen because it's easier for you to just go out and pick. You don't have them at the end of the garden and down.
Yeah.
So if you have a nice, warm, sunny spot on a patio where there's some reflection off the wall of like heat, so a nice, sunny, warm spot, and you can kind of shelter them. I know we've had like loads of rain and stuff. So if it is in like a container that's movable, maybe just move it into the like away from all of the rain.
If you can.
But they will take a bit of abuse. So if you do kind of go on your holidays and we have a dry spell, a lot of the Mediterranean ones like rosemary and thyme, sage and lavender, they will tolerate a bit of drought.
So are they the ones you would recommend to start with?
Yes. And then you can add in, so the likes of parsley. Parsley is like an annual.
The smell of the parsley. It's beautiful.
So this is really easy to grow from seed as well. And actually rocket is really easy to grow from seed. It'll germinate and grow within like 40 days. So you can keep sowing it continuously throughout summer.
Can we get him to do something?
Yeah, do you want to grow up, pot up a herb garden? So I have some rosemary here. Uh-huh. So if you want, you can, I like to lay them out first.
Oh, okay.
And then you can kind of plant. Now, everything in my box is quite packed together. In your garden, you can give it a bit more space for it to grow out.
And would this still work though?
Oh, absolutely.
It will.
Because you're going to be picking from it as well. And then you're going to be harvesting and using it. So it's not going to get too big because you're constantly going to be taken from it.
So what are these?
These are little rosemary.
Rosemary and thyme.
So if you are going to harvest, so I would let this one grow a bit bigger before you harvest it for using in the kitchen.
Does harvest it mean...
Literally just snipping it. Yeah. So like if you want this one here. So when you harvest rosemary, don't clip it back too far. It is, like lavender, it can get a bit woody at the base. So always leave a little bit of new growth underneath and just take like a couple of inches off.
Smells gorgeous.
Most of it, I kind of just like pick it off. Like parsley, you can pick from the base as well and just like pick
now,
it off.
Can I ask a stupid question?
Absolutely.
So you go to the, when do you plant these? Is it too late in the summer now to
plant
these?
No, you could build this now. If you want to grow from seed, which is the cheapest option,
so
the best
time. You go just and buy the little packets of seed in your garden center.
February, March, April is generally your seed sowing time. And then they're ready to be planted out. Herbs like parsley, they're not really frost hardy. Come like autumn time, they'll just die off. You can grow them indoors parsley in the kitchen.
On the kitchen windowsill.
Keep them on the windowsill,
and you should be fine.
And they'd be grand, they'll keep going.
Because we do have, like, we've got no space at the back, but we've got those flower boxes.
Yes.
And we planted a bunch of herbs.
Yeah.
But an awful lot of them flowered. Like, we try to keep an eye on them, but you go away for a weekend, and next thing we're like, how have we managed to ruin them.
Yeah, they bolt. So things like, it's okay if you're like rosemary and thyme flowers, they will flower in summer anyway.
Okay.
But if you have things like, you know, lettuce can bolt, they can get a bit bitter if they go to seed.
Okay.
But yeah, just keep picking them.
And with the rocket, see the way there's flowers on the top here?
Yes.
That's the way it's meant to be?
I think so.
You think? Okay, I love it. I don't know either. It's
not
fine.
Too sure about that one. Don't be asking me those hard questions.
We're all learning.
Okay, so like basically with this then, are we going to plant other ones?
Yes, so you can shop from the table. So I have some...
I can shop from the table.
Can
I? Oh, here we go. I'm shopping from the table.
So whatever you want.
I'd like to put that in. So like put that in the middle there like that.
And then just to add as well... That's chives.
Yeah.
And they flower. They have a lovely flower. Purple little flower on them. And the bees loved them during summertime
as well. Oh, that's so nice. So don't be afraid of some of them if they do flower.
No, don't be afraid. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And then as well, I just have a little bit of grit here as well. So if you are planting some of the Mediterranean ones, you can add in some of this horticultural grit just to give it more drainage because they do prefer a rich drainage.
They hate the soggy.
They hate the soggy.
They hate the soggy.
All right, what's this?
About that a lot. That wasn't... That was a display plant.
Oh, yeah. Nothing to do with the herb garden.
I have a tip about mint.
Go straight to the thing he's not meant to. I knew it. I was like, I've got to pick it up.
So if you see this one here, this is mint. And I just have a tip about mint. Don't put mint into like a container like this because mint is invasive and it can take over. But I do have an alternative. So this here, if you smell this, it is a geranium. Oh, sorry. It's a pelargonium and it smells like mint. You can also eat it. It's edible.
Oh.
And it won't take over the container.
Just
so...
take some there.
Oh, I don't want to kill it.
Ah, no, it's great.
Kill it.
So that's lovely in a little mojito.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
Mint is great for tea. As well.
Oh, yeah, putting it in your tea. Is there lavender? Do you do lavender?
You can, yeah, I have a little lavender down the front. You can add lavender in with your, like, rosemary.
Yeah.
They're all the same family. Love that kind of drainage, that kind of dry soil. You can also top dress your little box as well with some of the stones.
Is this geranium? Is that what you said?
That's a pelargonium.
Yeah, pelargonium. Get this. This is absolutely delicious. Where can people find you, Catherine?
At daintydressdiaries.com.
Daintydressdiaries. Nothing to do with flowers.
It's so relaxing. I absolutely adore watching your channel. Thank you so much, Catherine. We'll see you again very soon. Now coming up from bogeys to birdies. We're going golf mad here in the studio as broadcasters Pamela Joyce and Lorraine Keane talk preparations for their latest tournament.
Plus, we'll be getting a lesson in traditional Indian dance. Stay with us. We'll see you in a few minutes.
That's gorgeous.
That's gorgeous. Thank you.
Hello, welcome back to Ireland Day. I'm coming up a little bit later on this hour. We are going to diagnose you with a brand new condition. It's called errand paralysis. Basically, if you don't want to do stuff, you could have something wrong with you.
No idea what that is. We're going to find out a little bit more later on. Now, you might wonder why I'm holding a golf club.
No.
It is because we are, well, we're going to get a golf lesson very shortly by Lorraine Keane and Pamela Joyce. What? Well, listen, you are, of course, taking on golf.
It's
a new challenge, and it's all going to lead up to a big culmination in Dromoland Castle, is that right?
The KPMG Women's Open. And we've to take part. The Pro-Am, and we've literally just started playing golf.
He does
a few
it
weeks
all
ago.
The time. He gets to go for days out, has lovely dinners.
How are you finding it?
I'm loving it because I didn't think that I would. I didn't think I was the kind of golfing type. But you know, some good shots, some bad shots. More bad at the moment, but you're listening, it's all
fun. Crack. Yeah, I mean, we're getting there. We're getting more confident as we go.
She's brilliant.
Well, Warren keeps telling me how she's going to start playing golf.
I am starting the heels. I am starting to play golf.
Perfecting the swing.
Oh, I've got the hockey swing. That's
and
the issue.
With Leona Maguire and everyone else.
My dad
really
said I
driving really the
back.
Way.
Four.
In golf in Ireland as well. So looking forward to you getting more girls involved in the game. Now, let's see what else Alan is up to in this hour.
Oh, you're in your element there, Tommy. Yes, now, yesterday I was all jigs and reels at the Fla, but today I'm going to be doing a little bit of Bollywood dancing. Yes, so get ready for this because we're getting a one-on-one traditional Indian dance lesson at the end of the show this morning. So really looking forward to that. There we go.
Good morning, you're very welcome back. Now, earlier on in the show, we've been discussing many things, but one of those was, of course, about voluntary assisted dying. We had Justin McKenna, who is a probate law solicitor, and the chairperson for the End of Life Ireland, Janie Lazar, as well, on talking about it. And it was very interesting. It is with the Oireachtas at the minute. It is obviously illegal for it to happen at the moment, but they are hoping that it will be come through and that it will not be... be put into law.
It won't be treated as manslaughter in Ireland as it is. It carries a 14-year sentence, but so many
of you... A lot of people have, really agreed with it.
Yeah, Matt says, my mother passed away 2 months ago from cancer. It's the hardest thing to look at. I would like to see assisted, voluntary assisted suicide brought in, or dying, looking at a loved one in pain. I just don't want to be like that. It was awful, awful to see.
Thank you, Matt. I mean, for someone like a number of members of my family have died of cancer, and I could never understand the pain they were in. I just thought, my God, in this day and age, how could you still be in so much pain and even what they're trying to go through? And for those last days, it's just horrific.
Yeah,
it really is.
Yvonne, I lost my mum to MND, 2013. Horrific disease for the person and loved ones. Mum at the end couldn't even speak, swallow. She was very distressed. You know, it's cruel to put people through that in their final moments as well. Yeah. So I'm sure they've chosen.
Yeah,
absolutely. So, very interesting. Thank you for sending through some of your texts on that. Now, we also had a lot of response to a very different
gear change
type of conversation earlier on. It was the weird and wacky stories from around the world. And Alan found this story where there was a man who decided to turn himself into a dog.
But the thing was, he spent nearly €15,000 on a costume. Now,
we can take a look at the video here, hopefully.
Yeah, the dog costume. This is him in the dog costume. Look, it's absolutely incredible. It really is. We're just going...
But it's not really that great a costume, is it?
It's
But
fabulous.
We're trying to figure out how he's walking and what he's doing. He's given the paw. He's so
like
good.
The dog had Botox. It's not really moving.
By the way, this is in Tokyo.
He's given out about how the man looks as he's dressed. He's got bigger issues than whether he looks like he's got Botox. Now, I think we've got a lovely person sent in a video, I believe...
Of their dog.
Of their dog looking at the dog at us this morning.
Absolutely gone mental.
Now, it's fooled that dog.
See, look
at that. And you going on about doggy Botox.
Yeah, it's lucky that dog didn't come across it on the street, that's for sure. We also have a picture in from Shauna as well. My favourite costume I made for Halloween was my Mars Attacks alien. I wore to Workman's. I spent the week making it rather than being in college, but I did win Best Dressed and got 2 festival tickets, so it was well worth it in the end.
And this is my brother Jimmy. He made that Mirror Man costume because we were asking what costumes, because we were asking, have you ever dressed up in costume? And there's him. Look at that.
That's amazing. Right. Debbie, I live for Halloween. I start preparing months in advance and I do all my own makeup. I'm self-trained, by the way. Look at that.
Look at that. Love it.
Is that from Stranger Things?
How do you see?
That is so cool.
Love it
so much.
Do you do dog masks? Because we might put you in touch with some fella from Japan. Up next this morning, thank you for sending all those texts this morning. Broadcasters Pamela Joyce and Lorraine Keane, they're here. They're going to tell us why they're channeling their inner Leona Maguire.
I'll see you back here in a few minutes. To Ireland AM, where we're joined now by a dedicated follower of fashion and a radio DJ who fills the airwaves with laughter. Can you do that?
Right.
No, he can't do that. It is broadcaster Lorraine Keane and Today FM's Pamela Joyce. Good morning.
Good morning. This morning as well.
I wonder what we're talking about. We really have the props going on here. Let me think. Come here, Galway girl.
Yeah.
You were a golfer when you were younger.
I mean, a golfer is quite a strong term. I played a little bit. My dad really tried to force me into it. And then performing arts and golf were on at the same time. And no prizes for guessing which one I chose.
Which, sure.
Yes, so we went performing arts. And now I've decided I want to get back into it. Because it's the sport du jour. It's what everyone wants to do.
Well, I've seen you swing, and you can tell that you have a knack for it as well.
Thanks,
Tommy. And
as for you, Lorraine, you're not so much. I have a nice jumpsuit, though.
You do look fantastic.
And a glove.
All about the fashion. What is going on?
That you actually have a proper stylish glove. Of course you do.
That was actually dropped into me by a lovely woman called Suzanne Dalton.
She sorted it out. Yeah. Of course she did.
Thanks, Suzanne.
So why are you picking up the gloves?
Because we want to encourage more women and girls to play golf. It's something that I kind of thought I might do a little bit later in life, but then a few of my girlfriends started it a few years ago. I didn't take part. I was teasing them. They loved it. Then I started to get FOMO because they were talking about the wonderful days they were having out and, you know, just for the exercise.
An excuse, isn't
it? Yeah, to get together with your pals, have chats, and it's good for your mental health
as
well.
What if we start doing that? What if Lucy then starts going, you know what, I'm going golfing too. You stay at home with the kids for 5 hours.
Because
that's the thing.
You get to escape your teenagers for 4 to 5 hours.
But this is, a lot of my friends have taken it up in recent years because their husbands play and they're like, I'm going to do it as well, see what happens. And they've really enjoyed it because they get to have a bit of a laugh.
Yeah.
Like, we've been codded for a long time.
And it's the thing of, you know, you put your phone in your golf bag for 3 or 4 hours. And it, like, you just completely forget about the busyness of life and work and people at you all the time. You just go, you're outside, you clear your head. You hit some good shots, you hit some not so good shots, and you have a bit of fun.
Yeah.
It's a great way to catch up with friends as well. And even businesses, an awful lot can be done on the golf course. But it is a very, very frustrating sport, and particularly you get started with as well, Pamela. Yeah. Like, how have you found the journey getting back into it again?
I played hockey when I was younger. So I think that's actually kind of standing to me and not standing to me. I was a cornerback. So you get the ball by any means necessary, you smack it out.
Golf, but there are different swings.
Golf, a little bit more particular. Yeah. If your baby toe isn't in the right place, the ball isn't going in the right place. So it's slightly more, you know, skilled at golf. But it's been really, really enjoyable experience working with Golf Ireland, getting back into golf and kind of just learning, you know. It's fine. You do a few lessons. You go out, you hit the ball. You have to not care what other people think of you.
Yeah.
Because no one really cares. Yeah. As Lorraine said to me last day, so golf is a very selfish sport. Yeah. No one cares how anyone else has played. They just care how they're playing.
And you have the handicap system as well, which means it kind of levels the playing field a little bit.
Well, hopefully. I'll be the highest one. I think it's 54. That's what I'm counting on. You can actually see, though, we're filming it on a YouTube series called The First Tee for Golf Ireland, so you can see how we're progressing or not.
But you're doing a pro-am.
We are. The KPMG Women's Irish Open in Dromoland
Castle. He loves these things.
On the 30th of August.
Like,
honestly, Tommy, I haven't slept. Like, I picked up this for the first time 6 weeks ago, and I don't think I've had a proper night's sleep since, because all I'm worried about is that first tee.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean? When you've got an audience.
Imagine the poor people on the sides, how they'd be thinking whenever they see you teeing up in front of them.
Fair enough.
Yeah, if they see me practice, they'll be moving further and further back. But
isn't it amazing? Because Ireland and golf seem to go hand in hand at the minute. Obviously, you talk about McIlroy and Harrington and Lowry, whatever, but Leo Maguire. And there's a number of Irish female golfers as well are right at the top of the sport. And it can only be positive for boys and girls getting into the game.
Yeah. And I think that's really the key of us getting, me starting it for the first time and you getting back into it. And Valerie Wheeler from Spin FM is also doing it with us, is to show people that it actually is a really enjoyable,
very enjoyable,
fun sport. And as you said, an opportunity to get together with your pals. And
I suppose it's kind of thought of, it was, you know, hopefully it's not exclusionary, because there'd be a golf club in Limerick called Rat Band, open to the public.
Yes.
Everyone can kind of go. I suppose rugby in Limerick isn't seen as an elite sport. Everyone sort of plays it.
Yeah.
And that would be kind of the view people would have of golf.
That was my thing. I would have.
That's like, if you're not a member of the club, you can't come in and everyone's going to be very scary. But I've played quite a bit in Connemara. Everyone's lovely there. I played in Castletroy in Limerick, played in Dromoland, played in Carton House. And the people involved in golf are so friendly and they're so eager for people to get involved.
Yeah.
They're so helpful. Okay. It's really lovely.
You have been bigging yourself up.
I'll see you now. See you, Tommy. Thanks, Billy.
Whatever about the first tee at the pro-am.
Yeah.
Here we go, live on television. Pamela Joyce, you're going to step up.
Should I go first?
Come on, yeah,
that's
we've got
fair.
The track man.
I don't
here
want
as well.
Her.
We're going
I'm
to have
going.
A go and
my hands
see.
Are quite sweaty, Tommy. Huh?
Okay, no problem. This is nice and easy.
Lord knows where this is going to go.
Watch the car park out behind.
Right.
Oh, wow.
My hands were very sweaty there. That wasn't a good reflection of my golf now.
Okay, Pamela, that was 108 yards and 79 miles per hour.
Terrible.
Do you want to go again? Do you want one more? I'll go again. Don't say it's terrible. Here we go,
okay,
one more.
Okay. No, I can do better than that now. Right. No pressure. Oh!
Jeepers.
Even worse. Which is, it broke,
yeah,
I did it.
104.
It broke.
Yeah, 104. Broke.
Okay, okay.
In you go. You have to be at 108. 108.
You're like a darts announcer. Oh, look at you.
Oh, good Lord.
66.
I'm trying to think of my grip, my posture, my Y to L, my all here.
To.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just beat 108.
Okay. If I can just hit the ball out of it, I'll be chuffed with myself.
Oop. Nice.
No, 106.
Oh, oh, do you want to have one more?
Another go.
Have a quick go.
Okay, ready? Good one.
Oh, that's a good one.
Was that a good one?
That's a good one. Right, Lorraine.
Hold on. 126. 126.
And here we go now.
I'm going to get it in the car park.
Here we go.
Come on.
I'm going to get it in the car park, lads.
Now, Murrin, 126 to beat.
Excellent.
No bother.
Someone's car twice.
It went into the bush
twice.
Twice.
Ball. Hey, Golf Ireland. You want me?
It's someone's car.
It's in the bushes. You go.
Right, come on, Alan, show off.
Right.
I'll give it a go
We're all going to have one quick go.
We'll have one quick go.
We're on a break.
Careful, Warren. Hi, Alan.
Ooh, that's not bad,
that was
Alan.
Pretty good.
We'll be back.
It was in the bushes. I didn't hit anyone's
car. Only 81.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay. Right, last Tommy one. Now. You okay, made 120. Lorraine got 126. Tommy.
Sheeny mackers.
The sound of
Here
that.
We go. 247.
Don't worry about it. That's almost double what I did. Lorraine and Pamela, thank you so much for joining us. When is the pro-am for people to find out more?
It's on the Wednesday, the 30th of August.
And if they want to follow your journey on YouTube?
Yeah, look up the first tee with Golf Ireland.
What's it called, sorry?
The first tee. So that's a tee, Tommy.
The first tee.
Yeah,
there you go. Easy as that. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Now, coming up after the break, we're going to be discussing why errand paralysis has left a generation unable to cope with day-to-day tasks. We've also got lots more coming up after the break. See you shortly. Well done. I'm going again.
Welcome back. Now, if some of the most mundane tasks can often seem like the most difficult to complete, you are not alone.
It could be the very millennial problem of errand paralysis.
Yeah.
Who knows? Joining us to discuss it further is counsellor psychologist Leslie Shoemaker. Good morning to you, Leslie. Errand paralysis, what is it?
Exactly what it says on the tin. They are paralyzed by running errands. Post office, grocery store, returning clothes, little things like that.
I've got a boot full of stuff that I haven't returned. It's not errand, I'm just lazy.
Well, unfortunately, you got two camps. There are going to be people who just procrastinate and put things off. Whereas with these individuals, what they describe is feeling out-and-out anxiety, that they're frozen. So don't forget, when our brain interprets something as a threat, we have a mechanism, everybody has it, you know, it's just something we're stuck with, called fight, flight, and freeze. Mm. So for these individuals, they're either, you know, they're pretty much in freeze because going and doing errands is a threat.
So can errands be simple jobs around the house, like emptying the dishwasher, clearing the table, all the things my wife shouts at me for not doing? Is that just, like, I wouldn't say it's paralysis, but maybe not laziness as well. Sometimes it just slips my brain to do these things.
Yeah, we won't talk about household chores and husbands. That's a different thing.
That's different. And often times they just don't see it.
Yeah.
The way a woman will see a mess.
Yes.
So it's kind of different.
Yes. That's totally different.
What about finishing the job? So that was something my wife and I talked about as well. There is actually just in terms of bathing the kids, getting them out, getting them changed, getting them ready for bed, but then leaving all their toys in the bath. So then she comes along and has to clear that up. So it's actually about finishing the job that you're doing, is that?
Errand paralysis is a little bit different. Okay. This tends to impact the 22 to 37-year-olds, that particular generation. What we're seeing is they're describing full-blown anxiety in doing some of these things. One interview I was reading in an article, this poor man couldn't fill out a voting form for the states, couldn't figure out how to do it, even though people were helping him, and then the anxiety of dropping it off at the post office. What's happened with this particular generation is the reality is none of us, even us here, are going to make the kind of money that our parents did. We'll never have that financial security. So this generation, they're working more and more and more just to make ends meet. The other thing is, and I do blame...
So they don't want to fill out forms.
Well, I was going to also say the other problem is that with social media, they're being told, you must be saving the planet, you must be doing this, you must be doing that. So they're spending so much time being their best person that when it comes to doing some of these tasks, you have some people definitely lazy, some people who are almost in burnout, and then other people who have this paralysis, this anxiety.
Okay, so this makes more sense because I suppose when I heard about this, I was like, ah, come on now. It's ridiculous. And I'm sure there's an awful lot of people at home going, come on now. But then just get a bit of cop on. You don't want to do it, so you're not going to do it. But when you talk about sensory overload and the fact, as you mentioned, we will never have the security that our parents' generation had. And that's going to keep on going down and down for our children as well, which is something that people, I'm sure, are thinking about. So is this just an outlet then? Is this a way that they can let their anxiety out rather than being anxious at work and not being able to talk to their boss or that?
It's misplaced anxiety because the other part of it, another underlying aspect of this is boring. So this generation, forgive me for the moms and dads out there and for the educators, these young people are like, I have to have a job that I'm passionate about. I have to be making a difference. And that's a huge aspect with this particular group of people from in around 22 to around, we'll round it up to about 40. So it's sort of like, well, going to the post office is boring. Going to the grocery store is boring. So, I can't do it. You know, this is just not my cup of tea. Yeah. So part of it is just plain old avoidance and a myth that you have to enjoy doing things. Life has a lot of boring moments. We need to embrace them.
So if you're a parent or a boss, how do you deal with somebody, an employee, for instance, who doesn't want to do the bread and butter, the simple tasks, want to be off doing the fancy jobs, but initially you've got to do the groundwork?
You know, I think that there's simple things that people can do. One is teaching time management. You know, what is a priority versus what is not a priority? I'm guilty of that. I have no food in my press at the moment. I need to go grocery shopping today. No ifs, ands, or buts. I've rather procrastinated. So I'm now at that stage where I can't ignore it. But I think looking at time management, but also talking people through things. I know that employers are having a huge problem with this particular generation because of exactly what you've just said. They want to do the really cool jobs. They're not prepared to work their way up, and they don't understand why working their way up is building a framework to getting to those jobs. Not just a reward, but they're learning skills, information along the way.
Well, then really, is it society who's letting people down because we're putting so much effort into our jobs to try to earn money that we will never earn on the same pay scale as the previous generation? So we're the first generation that will be worse off than our parents, right? So can we not, like,
is
we should
that
be looking...
an excuse?
No, I'm not saying it's an excuse, but should we have more hobbies and interests outside of work rather than concentrating? Oh, work should be really exciting.
It's not about doing the bread and butter. Not worrying about the hobbies. Like, not worrying about exciting things, actually doing...
but having other interests rather than work. Do you know what I mean?
But you're both right.
Oh,
you're both right.
Well, good answer.
Well, no, but you are. Because
oh my God, you're actually if we were brother and sister, you're our parent right now.
But the brain's hardwired. This is a fact. The brain is hardwired to look for novel experiences. And when we find the novel experiences, we get all the happy hormones. We're rewarded by that. So that is part of it. But yes, at a society level, yeah, we are letting people down. And there's another part of it where, forgive me, I call it Leslie's Suck It Up Club. You know, we just have to get on and do it. Nike has the world's best slogan, just do it. Mm-hmm. And we know in psychology, behaviorism has the strongest research base behind it, because if we keep getting caught in our thoughts, if we keep treating our thoughts as facts, if we keep treating our feelings as facts, they can become quite sticky. We can get tangled up in them. Whereas if you kind of just allow them to be there but go, I'm going to get that done, you're going to be a lot more successful. So yeah, Nike, best slogan in the world.
Just do it. Okay, there you go. So if you've got some silly job that you need to do that's in the back of your mind, Stop putting it off. Just go out there and do it. Go to the shops today on the way home.
Yeah. Oh, we're going on holidays. We can't. We can't get anything done. Go pack the bag.
Leslie Shoemaker, thank you so much for coming in and talking to us about that. Yeah, we'd love to know what you think of that. 0896 111 111
Errand Paralysis. It's a new one today, definitely. Now, Alan is limbering up for another dance lesson. He was set dancing yesterday. Alan, what are you doing for us today?
Well, Muireann, I'll be donning my dancing shoes for a very special Bollywood performance that's coming up right after the break. We'll see you in a few minutes. Over there.
Hello.
Now you're very welcome back to Ireland, and we're about to break down the art of Bollywood dance.
Okay, not we won't be doing it. Giving us a masterclass in traditional Indian dance is Aparna Shukla from the Ireland India Council. Good morning. How are you?
I'm very well. How are you?
It is so lovely to have you here. So vibrant, and
we do. We feel
very vibrant today. So the India Day Festival is coming up. What is this and what's happening?
Yes, it is happening on 13th of August.
This Sunday
at Farmley Estate, Phoenix Park in Dublin. And you can expect a lot of entertainment between 11 a.m. and 5 p.m. So there will be different dance styles, and there'll be different stands for Indian hot food and solar exhibition, yoga and meditation. So the day is full of entertainment.
Now, Muireann, how many people do you think will be going on Sunday?
I'd say a lot. A lot.
9,000.
9,000 are going on Sunday.
Yes.
9,000.
Yes.
And you're inviting like as many as like people from all walks of life.
It's an open house,
9,000.
Open invitation for whole of Ireland to please come and join us.
You already have 9,000 coming. We're doing okay. I'm like,
yeah, I thought you were going to say maybe 200.
I was thinking maybe 500 people. 9,000.
Yes.
Are you ready to go? That's going to be a busy day.
There's going to be a lot of food stalls.
We are ready to rock and roll.
But this, because you've been doing this since 2015, obviously when COVID was here, it wasn't on. So it has evolved over the years and it's gotten to be a big event.
Yes, it is very big this year, especially because we marked the 9 years of India-Ireland friendship. And it is commemoration of Indian independence. So our Independence Day is on 15th of August.
Yeah.
So this is in relation to that. And this year, people have already travelled from India to attend India Day in Ireland.
Oh, wow. So they'll all be there on Sunday.
There are some guests coming today. There are people travelling from Amsterdam and Netherlands to perform in Ireland. So this has really evolved a huge amount in scale.
Amazing.
Wow.
Well, there are huge connections, you know, our Taoiseach and everything like that. Is Leo going? Are you going?
Leo Varadkar.
Leo, is he going to be there?
He is. He is our chief guest.
Yes.
He is coming, and his family has been a great supporter of the event. They never miss any India Day. So they have been there for every India Day since 2015. And himself and his whole family is coming.
That's lovely.
How's his dancing?
Does he do a bit of dancing? Does he do a bit of dancing?
Is he any good?
I have no idea.
We're not going to do a strictly out of 10 right now.
Is there a growing Indian culture in Ireland at the moment?
Definitely. You see a lot of Indian community celebrating their festivals with Irish community.
Mm.
You see a lot of Indian restaurants.
Yes.
And definitely cricket club is growing. So a lot of Indians are starting cricket club, badminton club. And Indian students, a big, huge influx of Indian students coming to Irish universities for higher education.
Wow.
And being a part of the Ireland India Council, I suppose, you know, we are living in times where you know, it's fraught. Things are fraught all over the world in relation to things. How is it going? Because you'd be a touchstone, I assume, for an awful lot of immigrants into the country from India.
Yeah, well, my role is to do cultural sensitization as a cultural coordinator. So it's both sides. So I train Indian nurses and Indian students, like what is Irish culture all about? Because I suppose I'm living here 20 years, I have some idea. And then on the other hand, I go and train Irish businesses about Indian culture.
So
that their staff feel more comfortable working with them.
Okay, lovely. And you're still after 20 years going, what's wrong with your tea?
Is that it? Is it still too weak for you?
Do we have a number of how many Indian people are living in the country?
About 50,000 Indians.
50,000.
Yes.
So a good proportion will be there on Sunday then.
Definitely. They're coming from Cork, Limerick, Galway, and all part of Ireland, wherever they are living. They will all be heading towards Farmley Estate.
Oh, that's a rule. Our partner knows that's going to happen.
There you go.
I remember a few years ago, pre-COVID, there was a Bollywood film being filmed in Dublin. I was in Dublin, and it was happening inside in Stephen's Green. And it was one of the most amazing things I have ever seen in my entire life. Because obviously Indian film is huge.
It is
big.
Bollywood.
And like these are 3-hour epics with these fight scenes done through dance. Yes. So is the Bollywood dance culture, or is the dance called Indian dance culture, how is that a big thing for the community in Ireland?
It is absolutely. Well, if you have even 5 or 6 Indians living in a locality or society,
They will definitely start
a dance club, and they will always come together because different parts of India have different dance style.
Yeah.
So this particular dance that the girls are going to perform, that will showcase all the 4 corners of India coming together and different moves from different parts. So yeah, you will definitely see dancers from India everywhere.
Where are you from in India?
I'm from North India in Kanpur, it's state of Uttar Pradesh, where Taj Mahal is.
Where the Taj Mahal is.
So I come from that state.
And what brought you to Ireland?
I came to Ireland to work as a midwife in National Maternity Hospital.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but now I work with VHI.
Yeah, okay.
That's fine. Hey, listen, you're doing your thing.
We're talking about Bollywood and dancing. So you're going
but
to
can we,
maybe
can we talk
show
for
us
one second about the traditional, like the saris? They're the most beautiful garments in the entire world, and so important to Indian culture.
It is. So sari is a fashionable garment. You can see the girls, they are wearing sari.
Mm-hmm.
So
it
has 100 of different draping style, and it is an unstitched 9-yard long or 6-meter long cloth. And it has 3 pieces. Three pieces are blouse and then petticoat, and then this long 6-meter long unstitched fabric.
And it's wraps around.
And the way it is wrapped around, you can actually put it on without any safety pins. You don't need, they have used safety pins because they'll be dancing.
They'll be dancing. Yeah. Can you imagine me in the morning?
Wrapped around it.
Imagine me in the morning trying to put that on.
Look, we've only a minute left and we want to see the beautiful traditional dance. So what?
Will you come in and...
Yeah, come in, ladies.
Do you want to learn something?
Well, do you want to show us one?
You show us. Let's
quickly.
See.
Okay,
go, go, go.
Here we go.
So you need to do a Bollywood tumka. So what you do
is put your right hand out.
And then out and in. Out and in. Out, in. Out,
okay.
In.
We're actually not very good at this, but you are brilliant.
So I'm enjoying it.
You're enjoying it. Take it away. Let's see. So Farmley on Sunday and have a
at
great
11 a.m.
day.
Please
thank
come.
You, Sam. Please come.
Come on in.
Everybody,
do your
welcome.
Thing.
Do your thing.
मेरे वतन की थोड़ी सी धूल मेरी
Continue dancing. We're just going to say a big goodbye from all of us here in Ireland AM. Coming up on tomorrow's show, presenters will be meeting some of the puppy pals competing in this year's Nose of Tralee competition.
Our Code Lines' Mark Prendergast is going to be here talking about his new single and solo career, all coming up tomorrow from 7 o'clock here on Ireland AM. Look at this,
yeah,
Alan.
And don't forget, everyone welcome to Farmley on Sunday. From 11, you can see lots of this, great food and great culture. Enjoy.
Enjoy.
It's fabulous.
It's absolutely gorgeous.
Myself and Tommy will be away next week having a bit of a holiday. You're in the safe hands of Alan Hughes.
Look really forward to that. Come on, we're in.
Look, you look gorgeous. Hello.